Welcome to the Band of Brothers. We meet each Friday morning at 6:30 at the First Baptist Church in Garden City. Our guests have spent some time this morning greeting each other and enjoying a hot breakfast. Now, let's get our Bible study underway.
All right, guys, we're in Exodus. And again, we're Exodus chapter number 3. And we are looking at this great story of redemption. And it's a beautiful story because it shows how God is working on both ends of this matter. God is doing something. God is preparing Moses for what he has prepared for Moses. And now God appears to Moses in chapter number 3, and he commissions Moses. Remember, the first chapters had to do with the persecution of God's people. Persecution is when you are in trouble for doing everything right, right? Persecution is when you hadn't done wrong. Punishment is when you've done wrong and you get in trouble. Persecution, you did right and you get in trouble. Joseph was persecuted, right? Because he did everything right, not wrong. And so persecution is to be harassed, and God's people are being harassed. In fact, God talks about that in Isaiah 52. He says that the people of Egypt harassed his people without a cause. God says it was without a cause. God didn't make them hate Israel. They just hated Israel because of what was in their hearts. You see that? And sometimes you'll find this out. That's that principle. When God blesses a person, you can count on it many times in the heart of fallen men for people to be jealous of that. Right? That's where so much of the ism comes from. Classism comes from this. You're blessed with something, and I hate you just because you're blessed with it. And so people will hate you because you're talented. People will hate you because you got favor. You brought in the favor. People will hate you because you got promoted. People will hate you just because God's favor is upon you. And so it's not that God made them hate you. It's that God blessed you, and because of what's the fallenness of their heart, they hated you. And that's what happened with Pharaoh. As he continually hardened his heart. Wasn't that God arbitrarily hardened his heart? And we'll talk about that in just a minute. But notice here in chapter number 3, God appears to Moses in this bush. It was a burning bush. It was a bush that burned and didn't burn out. One of the things we said last week is that we can all be a burning bush. Amen? We're old thorn bush, just like this was a thorn bush. And nothing perfect about any of us, but we can be a burning thorn bush. Amen? I've got my problems. The evidence of the curse in the fall is in my life. I'm just an old thorny old man, but I can burn, right? And so everybody can be, in some sense, a burning bush. A bush where the fire of God burns bright. And where people will turn aside like Moses did to see what's going on. Right? That's what a life of a testimony is, right? They're having a life where people can turn aside and that people can see. People can see you as a husband. People can see you as a dad. People can see you as just a Christian gentleman and turn aside to see what this is. They know your past. They know where you come from. They know what has happened in your life. They know you used to be a drunk. They know you used to be a womanizer. They know all of the, you used to be a racist. They know you used to be this thing or that thing or the other thing. But now God is burning bright in you and they turn aside to see. What a great opportunity, amen? And to be a place from whence God speaks, because God speaks loudly. God spoke through this burning bush. God can speak through your life. God wants to speak through your life. And just as Moses saw this burning bush, we can be that kind of a burning bush. And notice what he says here in verse number 4, and when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, right? God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. Now, we pointed out how God many times calls a person, calls them twice to emphasize the importance. And this is calling them also. Here's a great relationship. And God, we see this many times. Remember, we saw it with Abraham. Abraham was about to what? Plunge that knife into his son, Isaac. In Genesis chapter number 24, he's about to plunge that knife into that boy. Just by walking by faith, God says, take the lad up and sacrifice him on one of the mountains. I'll show it to you. Moses got up early that morning, got Isaac. Isaac wasn't a little old boy, by the way. Remember, there was a grown man. He went up to Mount Moriah, and Abraham's about to plunge that knife into him. And God says to him, Abraham, Abraham, do the lad no harm. You remember that? Moses, Abraham had this special relationship with God, and God stayed his hand. You remember he said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Paul, you know, our Paul, it was Saul then. He had letter in hand. He was persecuting Christians. The Bible says he was, I mean, literally out of his mind, trying to persecute Christians and turning children into orphans by having the kids, their parents killed and all of that. And God knocked him down one day going into Damascus in Acts chapter number 9. Saul, Saul. You remember Martha, Martha? Remember that? Oh, Martha, you're so worried about so many things. There ain't but one thing that's needful. Mary has chosen this. Now, he loved Martha, and Martha loved him, but Martha got cattywampus, right? That's a good Bible word. He got cattywampus. She got sideways, right? And it's so easy to do, especially in church work, to get sideways. You start feeling sorry for yourself. Nobody's helping. I'm here by myself. Elijah had that happen to him. You remember that? Elijah had that same thing. Just kill me. I'm by myself. God says, no, you're not, right? But Martha thought, she was put out with Mary, and she was put out with Jesus because Jesus didn't make Mary help her. And she was so, Lord, can't you see me here serving? And Jesus said, Martha, Martha, you worried about, you're so distracted about so many things. Settle down now. Mary has chosen what's the best. What is that? Just to be at my feet, hearing my words, right? That's what's most important, right? So we see this. Remember, we hear Simon, Simon. Remember that? Simon, Simon, Satan has desired to have thee. Right? Satan was going to cut a deal with Jesus to have Simon. Satan has desired to have thee, that he might sift you like wheat. I bet old Peter said, what you tell him? he desired to have me. Okay, what you say? All right? Jesus says, I've prayed for you. That kind of gives you the answer, right? I've prayed for you, and when you are converted, what? You go back and minister. You strengthen your brothers. In other words, there's some things, Simon, you're going to learn through this sifting process that you will be able to use. You know that the faults and the failures in life are the platforms upon which we stand to teach. Don't pack it in and run away because you failed, because you blew it big time. Right? So you've got failure in your past. And Peter had a colossal fall. Right? He was so sure of himself. I'm not going to deny you. These other guys going to deny you. Remember that? Peter had denied his nets 3 years ago, but he never denied himself. And Satan says, I can use that. Right? He desired to have Simon to sift him. And sure enough, 3 times Peter denied Jesus. Right? And he was so dejected and wept bitterly and would have been out of the ministry. He says, I quit. I'm going back to the fishing business. But Jesus appeared to him and Jesus recommissioned him. And Peter was able to strengthen others. Just like David. He says, purge me, cleanse me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, so that I might what? Teach. The misery, then the ministry. Don't forget that, right? But we see this over and over where God calls. Remember, we even hear Jesus saying what? My God, my God. There's a special relationship there. So now notice, Moses, verse number 4. And he said, here am I. Now Moses is kind of like reporting for duty. Here am I. Here I am. Here am I. Now, this is the Moses who had been prepared, not just in the courts of Egypt, but now this is the Moses that has been prepared in the school of God, in the wilderness of Midian, right? Learning the things that only the wilderness of Midian could teach him, and learning the ways of God and the timing of God. And so now is the time that the God who is aware is the God who is active, and the God is about to deliver his people 40 years later than Moses thought. But his ways are higher than our ways, and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Amen? And God was preparing Moses. God was preparing Egypt. God was preparing his people. And God was preparing the Canaanites. right? God was doing all things. It's like the timing belt in your car and making everything work in time. It's not just about time. It's about what? Timing. These things have to work in perfect timing. And God works all things after the counsel of his own will. And we don't understand it. That's why we have to walk by faith. The just shall walk by his faith, because we don't walk by explanation. We don't walk by our senses, because we're so myopic. There's so much we don't see. We don't fly at a 30,000 foot level. We don't see the forest. We're too busy in examining the bark on the trees to even see the whole tree. But God sees the forest. Amen. And so what we have to do is just walk by faith. And there is no other way. Without this, it's impossible to please God, to walk with God. It's impossible. You're not going to understand everything in your life. You're not going to understand everything in the life of your family. You won't understand everything in your community. Quit acting like you do. Quit acting like you understand everything that had to do with. Hey, listen, it is. We don't understand it. We have to walk by faith. We have to take God's word for it. You won't be able to understand anything apart from the word of God and God giving you the greater perspective. And so we see this now in Moses. Moses says, "Here am I." And he said, "Draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet. For the place whereon thou standest is holy ground." Circle that word holy there. First time it's used in the Bible. Now, the word holy is a word we see all through the Bible. And we become familiar with it. But this is the first mention of it. Okay? And it has to do with being what? What the word holy mean? Set apart. Right? Special and sacred and set apart. And so God tells him, take off your shoes. I find it interesting that in the Bible has some things to say about the believer and his feet. And in three senses, intenses in the world, we got to see, as we Christians, we have to see ourselves at least in these three ways, right? God calls us many things in the Bible. God calls us saints, right? Saints means set aside, set apart ones. That speaks of our holiness. So the word saint and holy and sanctified and hallowed, hallowed be thy name, all these are the same words, right? So we are the set-aside ones. We're the ones who are holy to God, set apart. Two kinds of people in the world, saints and ain'ts, right? So you are a saint or you ain't. And nobody confers this upon you. Nobody, they don't have to convene and have a meeting and declare me a saint. I am a saint, right? I'm set apart for God and his purpose, right? But the Bible speaks of us in several different ideas in the Bible. For instance, every believer is a worshiper. God is spirit. They that worship him, what? Must worship him in spirit and in truth. We're to worship God. And as worshipers, we see here, like Moses right here, we have to have bare feet. So in some sense, every believer walked through this world with bare feet. You know why? Because for the believer today, all ground is what? Holy ground. Why? Because we believe in practicing the presence of God. Because in the Old Testament, God had a temple for his people. In the New Testament, God has a people as his temple. Follow me? So there is no place so much so set apart as being holy for the believer. All ground is what? Every bush is a what? Burning bush, right? So this lectern here becomes an altar. The table I eat on is an altar. The bed I sleep in is an altar. It's all holy, right? And so in some sense, we have to see ourselves as barefooted worshipers. The barefoot, right? Take your shoes off. This is set apart. See this as being sacred. See this as being holy. And we know that because God lives in us and he goes everywhere we go, and God's presence is not represented by just hovering a kind of glory cloud over the mercy seat, but God is dwelling his people, indwelling his people. God is with us, right? So we are worshipers, and we're to have bare feet and see ourselves as walking through this world as worshipers with bare feet, understanding that where we walk is holy ground because God is with us. There's some seats over here, Patton. Over here. Yeah, there's some seats right here. But then, you know, the Bible talks also about Christians as not just being worshipers, but the Bible talks about Christians as being witnesses. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be what? Witnesses unto me. Right? Now, we have some law people in here, lawyers and judges and some bailiffs. We got all kinds of court officials in here today, right? A lawyer becomes an officer of the court, right? A judge is an officer of the court. A bailiff is an officer of the court, right? Am I speaking over my head, Judge? Am I right? I'm right, right? So far, so good. He says, okay, safe so far, all right? But you think about, well, you know, that won't be the first time I talked over my head now, I'm going to say. But you think about it now. We're witnesses. And God didn't call us to be the judge, the one who drops down the hammer and makes a verdict. God didn't call us to do that. He called us to be witnesses, not judges. He called us to be witnesses. He didn't call us to be the bailiff just to keep the order. He didn't call us to be a prosecuting attorney. He called us to be what? Witnesses in the world. You shall be witnesses unto me. What is a witness? A witness is a person with a testimony. Someone who's seen something, heard something, knows something, and tells what they've seen, heard, or know. Are you a witness? Have you seen something? Have you heard something? Right? I mean, and by the way, I have seen, not I seen, right? But don't you rather have a person who said, I seen something and really did see it, than have someone said, I have seen and hadn't seen nothing? So I seen something. Yeah, Your Honor, I seen it. Right? It's a person who have seen something, a person have heard something, a person who knows something, and who tells what they saw, what they heard, what they know, that's a witness. That's a testimony. Let the redeemed, right, not hearsay, not just what my mom and them said. I heard the fella say it myself, Judge, right? I saw him do this, right? So, when the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord, what? Say so. I've experienced redemption, so I say so. Right? The psalmist said, I believe, therefore I speak. Paul said, me too. I really believe this, that's why I'm testifying. Right? So as Christians in the world, we are worshipers and we're to have bare feet. But you know what the Bible says about a witness? They have beautiful feet. Turn to Romans chapter number 10. Romans chapter number 10, and this is the passage where Paul is talking. Yeah, that's the New Testament, guys. All right? All right. All right, that's Romans chapter number 10. All right. If you hadn't found it yet, just stop there where you are and look intelligent. I'm just kidding you. Hey, guys, what we do, though, is you get familiar with handling the Bible and find out where the books of the Bible are, right? So if you hadn't gotten there, you just stop and look on with a Christian. Now, notice. I'm just having a good old time. But you know what we ought to get familiar with handling the Bible and know where they are, right? Don't make you a better Christian because you know Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges. You can name them all. That make you a better Christian. It's not what we know. It's what we are. Right? Really, it's what we are. But do get familiar with it. Okay? That's one of the things I did. One of the first things I did was to go to the table of content and learn the books of the Bible. That's a good exercise. Okay? Just go right to the table of contents and learn the 39 books of the Old Testament, the 27 books of the New Testament. Learn the 66 books of the Bible, where they fall. Okay? So, what was I talking? Oh, here, Romans chapter number 10. Romans chapter number 10, I love this. It begins at verse number 9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, whosoever believeth in him shall not be ashamed, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord of all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they've not believed? Good question. Nobody gonna call on somebody they hadn't believed in. And how shall they believe in him in whom they have not what? Heard. People need to hear in order to believe. And how shall they hear without a what? Preacher. Now don't get the idea of preacher here, somebody up here standing on a platform with a lectern. The preacher is anybody who's talking, the witness, the one who is believes and therefore speaks. Let the redeemed of the Lord what? Say so. I'm just proclaiming. I'm just testifying. How shall they believe on him in whom they've not heard? And how shall they hear without someone telling them, a proclaimer? And how shall they preach except they be what? Sent. All right? God sends us out. As it is written, how what? Beautiful are the feet of them that what? Preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. This is Isaiah 52:7. That's what Paul is quoting. So he says, as worshipers in the world, we ought to have a sense of bare feet as we worship the Lord. All ground is holy ground. But as witnesses in the world, we ought to have a sense of beautiful feet that are always going and always testifying and always telling. That's why the feet are beautiful, because they're going all over. God says these are beautiful feet. The going feet are beautiful feet. Right? So we're to have those kind of feet. To go. The gospel, what does the word gospel mean? Good news. But for a lot of people, it's no news. You know why? Because we hadn't gone. Right? Maybe to my next door neighbor, it might be no news. Because they hadn't heard. See how the good news can be no news? The good news, the war is over, but it's no news to some people who still continue to fight. They hadn't heard. That's why feet are beautiful that go. And they go preaching the gospel of peace. God knows we go on vacation. We go all over the place. We go to Athens. We go fishing. Why are we going with the gospel? As we go. Idea. So we have bare feet and we have beautiful feet. Then, you know, so that means we are worshipers. See ourselves in some sense, we are worshipers. Every person who names the name of Jesus, worship him. Okay? Who I am. All ground is holy ground. We're witnesses. Because I know him, I go tell what I know. Right? But we're to have battle-ready feet as warriors. So a Christian is a worshiper, a Christian is a witness, and a Christian is a warrior in this world. Because we are behind enemy lines. The Bible talks about how this world is no friend of ours. And so what does he say about our feet? Ephesians 6, you know this. Ephesians chapter number 6, turn over there. And it talks about warfare over there. Right? So yes, we're worshipers, but we're also warriors. We're in a fight. We're in the fight, guys. Yes, we're witnesses, but we're in the fight. And so the whole passage over in Ephesians chapter number 6 is about standing your ground, having your feet battle ready. Right? In some sense, I have bare feet. In some sense, I have beautiful feet. And in another sense, I have battle-ready feet. I have my feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, and I stand my ground. Over and over, it says over here that I stand my ground. Ephesians chapter number 6, and look at verse number 13. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to what? Withstand or stand in the evil day, and having done all to what? Stand. Stand, therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and what? Your feet shod, or having on the shoes, have your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. You know, these Roman soldiers would wear these sandals that were like cleats. Today, you know, you have baseball players and golfers and football players. They have these cleats that bite down into the earth so they can what? Stand their ground. You can't go out there and play on the line or play running back with bedroom slippers on. You got to have these things that dig in so you can stand your ground. Get traction. Right? And this is the idea. That's those Roman soldiers with those old hobnail sandals that dug into the ground. They just had that shield there and that sword in their hands, and they just don't move. Advance. So he says to Moses, take off your shoes, right? Have bare feet. He says to all of us today, as he says to all Christian missionaries and preachers and evangelists, go with those beautiful feet. And he says to all of us as warriors, dig in, stand your ground. So you see in this particular thing how we are three things in the world, and we can't forget that. All three of them, always worshiping, always witnessing, always warring. He says to Moses, take your shoes off. This is holy ground. First mention of the word holy in the Bible. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Here's the idea here, that I'm the God who has appeared to them. These are the big three, the patriarchs, the fathers. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. Before long, Moses is going to be asking, God, I want to see you. I want to look at you, God. And Moses is right now in this growing relationship with God. Now, Moses, how old is Moses? 80. All right? And Moses knew God when he was 40. He knew God wanted him to deliver his people. He was just out of sorts and out of timing. But here at 80, Moses is still growing. And he's learning more about God now at 80. And he would learn more about God and draw closer and closer to God. And that lets us know that we all ought to be growing. We ought to be like evergreens, always growing, always productive. It's going to either be that, or as I've said so many times, we're going to be a dried up stick, a brittle, lifeless stick, right? We'll always be growing in our relationship with God, always time to be growing. In fact, the older you are, the closer you ought to be walking with God, right? The longer we've done it, the more I ought to be want to do it. I ought to be blazing brighter and brighter and brighter. Not retire, but refire, right? Moses is 80 years old, right? And he's not headed off to Gatlinburg, right? Or you know, that's a concept that we have about retiring. But Moses is growing. And notice he says, Moses was afraid to look upon God. He hid his face, right? And the Lord, this is the Lord, said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people. Circle my people right there. That's the first mention of God and Israel as a nation being my people. Like, again, we use the word holy now because we stand 2,000 years on the other side of the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, and 3,500 years on the other side of this. And so we are so familiar with talking about my people, my people, my people, as it pertains to the Jews. But God says my people, this is first mention here. Holy, the first mention right here. It's always something important about the first mention of anything in the Bible. And one of these days I'll let old Buddy Watson come up here and explain it to you, all right? Or Darrell Bailey, one of these preachers, one of these theologians, all right? But the first mention, the principle of first mention, you can follow it throughout the Bible in it. And there's a string of truth that follows all throughout the Bible, all right? When you look at the first mention of something. But God calls Israel my people right here when he's talking to Moses. And Moses is seeing God, and Moses is listening to God outside of the burning bush, okay, with his shoes off, with his face covered. And God sets in, the Lord says, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows, and I am come to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up. Now notice God says in verse number 7, three things. I have seen, I have heard, and I know. And then verse number 8, I'm come. That's a good sermon outline there for you preachers who don't need nothing to. In fact, let me give you 7 points on a good sermon, all right? This is a good Sunday school lesson to teach or whatever. But God gave me this when I read behind somebody else, all right? No, really. Here's the thing. Point number 1, the people God sees, verse number 7. The people God claims, rather. The people God claims. God claims his own. Aren't you glad about that? God claims Israel with all of their faults. And boy, you're going to see them on display. You're going to see them in their unbelief and their hard-heartedness and all of their rebellion. You're going to see it. But God still claims them. Aren't you glad about that? That God claims his own. Now, if you belong to God, God's going to claim you. God claims you. And the Bible says about Jesus, he's not ashamed to call us brethren. Right? Jesus declared us right before the Father, all the myriad of angels in heaven. Jesus said, this is my brother. That we're a ragtag group, but we're his brother. Here we are, right? Right? His dysfunctional family, you're right. I'm not a claim. Joseph owned his brothers right before Pharaoh. Said, these are my brothers. There they were, man. Dusty old shepherds, the abomination of the Egyptian. Joseph said, this is my crowd. And God claims his people. We see that in verse number 7, my people. The people God claims. Number 2, the problems God sees. He says, I've seen the affliction. Aren't you glad that God sees the problem? Sometime with maybe somebody in here this morning, you've got some stuff. You have dilemma. You are hard pressed. You have problems in your marriage, in your business, in your health, in your life. It's good to know that God sees the problems in your life. That man who had been on his bed for 38 years in John chapter number 5, the Bible says the Lord knew his case. And he knows your case, right? He don't have your case file mixed up. He knows your case. And it's just good knowing sometimes, just good knowing that he knows. Isn't it good to know somebody knows? And it's better to know he knows if nobody else knows. But he declares himself as being a God who claims his people. And then number 2, he says, I've seen their affliction. So he's the problems that God sees, the people God claims, the problem that God sees, the prayers God hears. Notice, he says, I've heard their cry. Isn't it good to know that God hears our prayers? Isn't it good to know that God can interpret our tears? Huh? He keeps a bottle. He has a bottle for our tears. And sometimes a cry is not some intelligible language. The Bible says they were moaning and they were groaning. Unintelligible, but it was the ache of the heart. Do you know that God can interpret the ache of a heart? Don't you know that the Holy Spirit of God prays for us with groanings which cannot be what? Uttered. Some of my best praying I did when I couldn't say nothing. Am I right? Don't get to thinking you really praying because you're impressing God with your vocabulary. You know this phony baloney public prayer we do. Real prayers when the ache of my heart is heard in heaven. Right? I've heard their cry. I've seen their tears. I know who they are. The people God claims, the problem God sees, the prayers God hears, the pain God knows. I know their sorrows, God says in verse number 7. Your pain matters, right? God knows there's a pain in the offering. God knows, hey, listen, God knows that. God knows Abraham. Now, we see Abraham rising up early in the morning, right, to take Isaac. But you know there was a wrestling match that night on that bed. There's pain in the offering. This is his beloved son. God knows about offering something that's painful. God offered his son. Right? That's why as a preacher sometimes the best thing you can do is just commend people to the grace of God. They've lost someone. And nothing you can tell them but just lean on God's breast and cry. Don't tell people, oh, don't cry, she's in heaven, don't cry. Don't cry. Right? And God knows that. Sometimes we act like we're made out of brick and mortar. Right? People are not brick and mortar. The struggle is real. The people God claims, the problems God sees, the prayers God hears, the pain God knows. Verse number 8, I love this. The presence God gives. Verse number 8. Y'all writing this down now? All right. The presence God gives. In verse number 8, he says, I'm come down. God says, I'm here. The nearness of God. Amen. You in a storm, Jesus come walking on the storm. He knows about the storm. He comes walking on the storm. He uses the storm as a vehicle to get closer. He uses the sorrow. He uses the pain. He walks upon those things. And he is near, and he gives his own presence. Right? There's a line in that great song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. It talks about his own dear presence to cheer and to guide, God himself. God says, I'm here. The people God claims, the problem God sees, the prayers God hears, the pain God knows, the presence God gives, the purpose God has. God has a purpose in all of it. He says, I'm come down and I'm going to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians. God has a purpose. And I'm going to tell you something. Even though God has a purpose to deliver them, it got worse before it got better. Yeah. Right. Amen. You don't want to hear that. But it got worse before it got better, and it can happen. They got mad with Moses. Moses, now look, now you done woke up old Pharaoh, the fool. He's a fool anyhow. Now you got us out here. But you know what God was doing? God had a purpose. God had a purpose. And you know, sometimes we talk about the temptations and all of the aches that comes with being aged. We have people, anybody in here 90 years old? All right. All right. Jim is out. That's a World War II vet over there. Let's praise the Lord for them. They ain't few of them. Maybe. They ain't a bunch of them. And a Marine, all right? All right, all right. So we talk, there are some peculiar temptations that come with being aged that younger people don't know about. But the older you get, you learn, don't you? Right? And so Jim knows some things. The older he gets, and the temptations to kind of quit, and to sit down and not be engaged and all of those things, right? And you say, man, there's a burden that comes with old age. This old body is betraying you. Your eyes can't see. That's what Solomon was talking about, by the way, over in Ecclesiastes 12. He said, remember, God, when you're young, before the evil days come. He's talking, the evil days he's talking about is not some calamity in life. He's talking about old age. And that whole passage, he begins to describe old age, right? You can't see out of the window anymore. He's talking about your eyes. You know, he's just those peculiar burdens that come with being aged, right? Then not only that, the people you love all die and they're going to heaven. They moved away. And here you are here with a bunch of whippersnappers who don't even... You know what I'm saying? People don't appreciate life as it is. I mean, that really, that's what happens with old age, right? There are, you know, those growing burdens when you grow older. The body is falling apart. The loved ones are going, and it just seems that you get lonely. Your kids and grandkids are busy with other stuff and all of that, And what happens in that process is what I'm showing you, is that no matter how bad it is, there is a process, something that is going on. And here's what is going on. Hey, that's another 90-year-old right here sitting at this table, Drayton, Herman Drayton. That's right, right here. All right? Hey, that's right. That's my father-in-law. I didn't even see him there. But there is this process, though as bad as it has gotten and it is getting, there is a process that God is doing something. And what God is doing, and he's causing this old world to lose its gravity on you. You know what I'm saying? When you young, and man, look like the world's so bright, boy, you got everything in the world to live for, and you'd stay here forever if you could. But the older you get, and this old body falls apart, and your friends moved away, and your loved ones gone, and it's not like it used to be, this old world is stinking worse and worse. You see things on the news you never would have dreamt. This world begins to lose its gravity, and before long you're saying, even so, come Lord Jesus. Amen? That's what was going on here in Egypt. God was going to turn it up on them so that before long they were saying, we want something better than this. So even in old age, God is doing you a favor, right? He's causing you to want for some things that are higher, things that are nobler. These allure my sight. I want to go to Jesus, fly away and go. And you've heard people say this, I'm tired now. I'm tired. I just want to go over. And so God has a purpose, and God was going to deliver them out. But before doing that, he was going to cause Egypt to lose its grip on them, so that they could want for themselves what God wanted for them. And I want to tell you something. Every one of us will be better if we want it for ourselves, what God wants for us. Amen. Father, thank you so much for meeting with us this morning. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your men. Help us, dear God, to be doers of the word and not just hearers only. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We trust today's message has been a blessing to you. You can forward this program to a friend who may need to hear the word of God. Invite them to join you at the First Baptist Church in Garden City next Friday morning at 6:30. A hot meal is waiting for you. You can help the Kenny Grant Ministries. Contact us at the Kenny Grant Evangelistic Ministries.org. Thank you. May God's message be a blessing to you.
We're a band of brothers, just in perfect men. broken host of sinners made whole again. We praise you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. We're a band of brothers. Lead us in this place.